Yeah, I thank the organizers for the invitation to this interesting session, and I will try to tell you a little bit about stem cells. The heart is generated by stem cells during embryonic and fetal life. And throughout life, the heart is maintained by stem cells and cells by precursor cells, which are residing either in the heart and outside of the heart and are replacing the heart cells. I will come to this later. Stem cells, their option in the adult body is that they remain stem cells through by asymmetric replication. And the preservation of this mechanism is the basis for survival of the organism. You are dependent on stem cell function all throughout life in all tissues. If there is a symmetric replication of progenitor cells, then there is only a definite survival of the differentiated cells depending on their lifespan. During development of the heart, there is, of course, derivation of one pluripotent state embryonic stem cells, which can be brought into culture. And it's now very well studied that there is a chain of differentiation events which lead to ventricular cardiomyocytes or different other heart cells. And there is also heterogeneity of heart cells, atrial cells, ventricular cardiomyocytes, which is also derived from first heart field progenitors and second heart field progenitors, which can differentiate in different directions into muscle cells and endothelial cells, postnatal cardiac progenitors, surviving stem cells, cardiac conduction cells. This process is very intensively studied in basic research, but of course not completely understood. But it's clear that there are different regulating genes which can, like MESP1 and others, which are driving the differentiation of stem cells and then differentiated cardiac cells. Interesting is that not only in the heart there are progenitor cells and stem cells in embryonic, fetal, and adult life, but they are also immigrating cells from other tissues, like from the bone marrow. And this is a major discussion of therapies driven from these cells in the bone marrow that can immigrate the heart and may have regenerative functions in the heart. The detection of cardiac stem cells is quite, this is showing the bone marrow stem cells, which of course replace bone marrow form hematopoietic stem cells, but also can emigrate in other tissues like muscle tissue, epithelium, or neuron, and can differentiate in other cell types or form angiogenesis in other throughout the body. In the heart, it was the dogma until 2002 that there are no cardiac stem cells in the adult life. This is not the case. They have been detected by Anversa's group and further characterized. And there are not many c-Kit positive stem cells in the heart, but they are detectable in adult life. They can be cultured, and they also may be a source of therapies or pharmacological activation to induce proliferation. Looking at heart transplantation, where are the features where stem cells may play a role? I make some points I would like to address. First, the main part, I think, is heart failure treatment. As we discussed earlier today, heart failure is an entity of different diseases leading to diseased heart tissues. And of course, depending on that, there are attempts to treat. Transplantation is one of the options, drugs, mechanical assist device. And there's a question mark for stem cells for myocardial repair. Of course, they are a potent tool to treat and to regenerate or to remodel the heart. But of course, it depends on the disease and the cell type and the application technology which can be used. In the cell therapy for the heart, this is a new technology beyond organ transplantation and is in the clinic only for 10 years now, starting with the first skeletal myoblast injections by Menashe's group. Now we have more cells, more stem cells also applied for this treatment, including stem cells generated from the heart. There are different techniques, mobilization of stem cells in the circulation and direct application. And of course, it's a very large field of therapies which is coming and also is applying to cardiac surgery. Of course, in cardiology, there is a major activity by catheter application of stem cells into the coronary circulation and by a NOGA system, by endocardial application injection, intramyocardial injection. In the surgical access during open heart surgery or minimal invasive surgery, of course, direct application of stem cells to different sides of the heart is quite easy and can be used for new therapies directing different diseases. First clinical stem cell applications are now already 8 years ago, and Strauber in Düsseldorf started with the intracoronary application. I started in Rostock with the stem cell application to the chronic ischemia in CABG surgery. These therapies use different cell types, but the main cell type used for therapies is bone marrow stem cells or unmodified bone marrow, and it's based on a huge number of basic research publications in mouse and large animal models showing that there are regenerative options of bone marrow cells when injected into the heart. In acute myocardial infarction in chronic ischemia, there is a heavy debate of on the potential and the mechanisms of this regenerative actions, and starting from Orlik and Versa's publication in Nature, there was a rebuttal debate with further Nature papers by Murray and Balsam in 2004. And actually, drawn from these experimental studies, it's known now that bone marrow stem cells are able to induce vascular formation, angiogenesis in the heart. These vessels are derived from the bone marrow endothelial cardiovascular precursor cells. There is a very limited potential for cardiomyocyte differentiation, although it was negated by the Murray and Balsam group. It's now clear that also in the bone marrow there are cardiovascular progenitor cells to a very limited extent. The major effect is a reduced myocardial infarction site, acute myocardial infarction, and also a regeneration of heart, especially aiming at the border zone of the infarction or in chronic ischemic tissue, both by direct injection of bone marrow stem cells as well as by intracoronary or intravenous injections. These phenomena have been found. And the pathomechanisms have been further outlined, showing that this is not really a cellular replacement phenomenon, but it's a cellular release paracrine mechanism, which induces cardiomyocyte regeneration, angiogenesis, and anti-apoptotic factors. And if you take the supernatant of cultured stem cells and inject them, this supernatant into the heart tissue, then you find also the same effect as using the cells. So the cells are kind of factories for regenerative actions in the heart tissue. Beyond that, there is much interest in embryonic stem cells and iPS cells that are induced pluripotent stem cells from patients' own tissue. Their potential is discussed to differentiate into cardiomyocytes and to restore completely the heart tissue in acute myocardial infarction, but there is very limited experimental evidence at the moment, and this technology is in a very early state and not not easy translatable to the clinical scenario. So, as shown in this review by Segers and Lee last year, it's a very big field which is new. There are different pathomechanisms, cardiac regeneration, cardiomyocyte proliferation, the activation of resident cardiac stem cells by other cells or by factors and drugs, and also the mobilization of bone marrow stem cells to the heart and repair mechanisms, but also influence on inflammatory mechanisms. The outline of clinical studies showing in this review is quite broad. There are many thousands of patients now treated, several hundred with intramyocardial injection, several thousands with intracoronary injection, but there are multiple indications, even not listed here. The indications range from acute myocardial infarction to chronic ischemia to cardiomyopathy, Chagas disease and other indication, and although ejection fraction improvement is the main aim of most studies, I think it's a very mixed entity of clinical experiments at the moment, which needs further detailed analysis. Although in the waiting list situation for heart transplantation, intracoronary application of bone marrow stem cells have been applied, with some improvement in this study from Istanbul in Turkey. Many other studies are there with different indications and different cell types, different dosages, and different application technology, intramyocardial injection, catheter injection, and so on. So it needs a very a more stratified clinical setup. We started with a defined setup with CABG surgery, chronic ischemia, myocardial transition remodeling phase 2 weeks to 7 months after acute myocardial infarction in 2001. It was the same protocol as what was used by Menashe for skeletal myoblast, and we went on with this study for the last years, doing several phases of development of the application of purified stem cells from the bone marrow. We completed phase one, phase two study, and have started now a phase three study, and beyond that treated this indication in more than 120 patients. The methods here is what we use is bone marrow from the iliac crest is purified by clean room technology for the isolation or purification of CD133 or CD34 and c-kit positive stem cells. They are then directly injected in small volume into the border zone of myocardial infarction in a chronic ischemic patients with deteriorated ejection fraction. The experience from the clinical studies in this moderate heart failure patients is that there is a pronounced effect on the regeneration of the ejection fraction by 10%, also in late term. This was significant in a controlled, randomized phase 2 study versus CABG surgery alone, and it was dependent on the ejection fraction. With ejection fraction below 35%, there was a very pronounced improvement of ejection fraction in up to more than 15%. The main effect we see in perfusion imaging is that there is a restoration of perfusion in peri-infarction areas, which is independent of the bypass effect and is also present in long-term analysis up to three years and longer. And this perfusion improvement and leads to a long-term effect on the preservation of ventricular function with preservation of end-diastolic volume in the stem cell group versus controls, which show a long-term dilatation of the ventricle after 41 months. So that we see a clinical effect, there is safety of the treatment, and we are studying this indication now in a phase 3 study in heart failure patients with a CABG indication. With respect to heart transplantation, of course, bridge to recovery and bridge to transplant are interesting entities, but there is very limited experience, especially limited experience also in animal models. Potentially, it can be discussed that there is use for immunosuppression of T regulatory cells, suppression of stem cells like mesenchymal stem cells. This might have an impact in the treatment of viral myocarditis and also in systemic inflammation in assist device patients. But also there are attempts and ideas in multiple reviews, but no practical experience so far, about the use of stem cells in assist device to patients for bridge to recovery with skeletal myoblasts, hematopoietic cardiac stem cells, mesenchymal stem cells, and beyond the pharmacological treatment, clenbuterol and erythropoietin, which are also potent stem cell mobilization drugs. In the literature, I found only one case now recently published by the Osaka group of a skeletal myoblast and bone marrow cell implantation in a LVAD patient. There is some myoblast transplantation experience present in patients that received skeletal myoblasts, but they all were transplanted later, and the clinical effect of the cell transplantation was very limited. There is basic research ongoing in the LVAD patients that there is stem cell factor expression potential bone marrow mobilization activity, but the clinical research in this field is very early. The potential to use stem cells, as it has been mentioned, for immunomodulation after heart transplantation may be also very interesting, but also this is, although it is a very old basic research topic since more than 50 years, it's clinically not very apparent at the moment. Tolerance induction has been stated. I will give some examples of bone marrow chimerism of donor and recipient, the immunosuppressive potential of mesenchymal stem cells and secreted factors like AHLAG may be potential for heart transplantation tolerance induction. And finally, there is the option to exchange the donor heart by recipient cells, which may be also an option for long-term change of the donor hearts. Mesenchymal stem cells are cultivated stem cells from the bone marrow or from other tissues, and they have a very strong immunosuppression activity, which is known in hematology, and it's used in hematology for graft versus host disease treatment. This potential has been studied in experimental models, also in a baboon model, quite extensively, and it has been shown that the allogenic response of mixed lymphocyte reactions can be reduced, profoundly induced by the addition of mesenchymal stem cells to in vitro mixed lymphocyte reactions. If you transplant in this baboon model, then with a third party or donor skin transplant, you see a prolongation of transplant survival and reduction of rejection, but of no tolerance, but a prolongation of rejection by 1 week. The experiments done in bone marrow transplantation show a proof of principle that this short time immunosuppression of mesenchymal stem cells can be used in the context of graft versus host disease, and it may be also used for acute rejection treatment or early transplant condition of the patients. The basis for the knowledge is quite limited, but it seems that there is, if you inject the mesenchymal stem cells in animal models or in humans, that they reside in the bone marrow, and also in the intestine, but also can reside in other organs and have secretory actions. They are not resident in the transplant primary, but they are systemically active to and have an immunoregulatory action. And this action is, as it has been depicted by an excellent review by LeBlanc from Stockholm, who is one of the leaders in this field, has different immune regulatory actions on different immune cells, regulatory T cells, activated T cells, dendritic cells, T helper cells, cytotoxic cells, and so on. These actions have been described, but are not well understood. But it's also in this context a paracrine action of the mesenchymal stem cells, which is immune modulatory. These cells have a paracrine effect on the immune system. One of the key molecules which could be interested in this context and which is expressed by mesenchymal stem cells is HLA-G. It's a class 1 molecule, HLA molecule, which has been detected recently, 8-9 years ago in Paris by Carosella's group. And this HLA-G molecule is expressed on mesenchymal stem cells, but it's also a main torogenic molecule which is expressed by the mother in during pregnancy and reduces the allogenic response to the fetus in the placenta. And this molecule may be used in transplantation. It can be secreted by MSCs, but also it can be expressed in the organ transplant. It may be also can be induced, and it has also a high potential of immunosuppression of different immune cells, as it has been shown for MSCs, also on the cellular side, but here on the molecular side. And it may have a major impact on the treatment of immune diseases, including transplantation. Transplants have been studied for the expression of HLA-G, and it seems that the liver transplants are very tolerogenic, and there is in known rejecting liver transplants a higher expression of such HLA-G molecule as, for instance, in bile ducts. Plasma levels are increased, and so it's not well studied, especially not well studied in heart transplants, but the long-term surviving graft expression of HLA-G may be one potential for tolerance induction or immune downregulation. And the application of either mesenchymal stem cells or stem cells which are manipulated to express these molecules may be an option for modification of the host immune response in long-term transplant, heart transplant recipients or heart-lung transplant recipients. This is in this review in Cell from Carosella from this year, description of the effects of HLA-G. I will not go in detail, but it's a very potent molecular system. It's known in basic in small animal models, in the mouse and the rat, that this class 1 molecular system is a tolerogenic molecular system which has effects on transplantation survival. Bone marrow transplantation has been used with this idea in renal transplantation, with a combination of bone marrow transplantation without myeloablative preparative regimen and kidney transplantation. And the experiments of this program in Boston has been published last year. there was a discontinuation of immunosuppression after 1 to 2 months, and there were some treated acute rejections, but normal kidney function without immunosuppression in 4 of 5 recipients, where there was 1 rejection. So there is initial experiments of a tolerogenic conditioning of organ transplant recipients, including donor bone marrow transplantation. Shortly to cellular chimerism, I did my own studies in 88 on heart transplants where I used donor and recipient-specific antibodies. I found that interstitial cells of the heart in after 1 year are for 50% replaced by recipient cells. So there is a independent from rejection exchange of donor cells by recipient cells, which are mainly immigrating from the bone marrow. This has been studied now with Y chromosome detecting technology recently and published in Transplantation. And it was shown that cardiomyocytes are replaced by 5.4% in fully mismatched bone marrow transplant recipients. And in a heart transplant recipient, after a year, there are 3.5% of the cardiomyocytes of recipient type. 16% of the endothelial cells are of recipient type, and 14% of the smooth muscle cells in the vasculature. So there is a gradual exchange in a heart transplant, which is not influenced by the current technology and immunosuppression. And there is also a science paper further delineating the cardiomyocyte turnover in the adult heart. From April this year, they used C14 technology to look for the age of the nucleus of the cardiomyocytes. And they found that up to the age of 25, there is a 1% turnover of cardiomyocytes per year, and up to the age of 75, 0.45. This is shown the technology. They isolated the nuclei of the cardiomyocytes, and they could, by C14 levels and according to the nuclear bomb, C14 levels, which were very high, look at the age of the cell, individual cell. And by this, they could show that with age, 50% of the cardiomyocytes are exchanged in individuals of 50 to 60 years. And there are 60% surviving original cardiomyocytes. This concept, I studied this in heart valve receding with SLR matrix. This concept may be used in technology when you try to reseed SLR matrix tissue engineering hearts, which was done by Taylor's group last year, where they could show that you may seed a heart even if it has no cells containing. But this seeding technology can be used in heart transplants to modify the exchange of cell types during the course after transplantation. What that needs to be done? I think we have to standardize the current cardiac stem cell therapies. We need solid indications in heart failure treatment, which we can use for preventing heart transplantation. We are doing this in a phase 3 study with Berlin and Hannover at the moment, where we try to standardize the treatment in patients with 25 to 40% ejection fraction and CABG indication. And after that, I think further treatments have to be applied in the context of immunomodulation and modifying the cellular exchange of the heart, which I think is fascinating technology and will, I think, change of cardiac surgery in the future. Thank you.